to Bible Baptist Church. Let's all stand together and sing number 5. Number 56.
If you believe that God has done great things, say amen. Amen. It is good to see you here. I'm thankful that you're with us for our Sunday morning worship service. I always like to say it's good to begin the day and the week in the Lord's house with God's people, and I'm glad that you're here. It's great to have guests with us, too, for the very first time, and you are a special blessing to us. We thank you for being with us. And I want to read from Psalm 126 as we get started this morning. We've sung praises about and to God at the very start. And I want to read with you Psalm 126, a psalm that motivated us to choose that psalm that hymn that we just sang this morning. So here's Psalm 126. If you notice, it'll be on the screen behind me, but also if you've looked at it in your Bible, it says a psalm of degrees. So there's when you read in the Psalms a psalm of degrees, it's talking about an ascent. It's a degree like an angle. And these were psalms that were sung as the Jews made their ascent up the mountain to Jerusalem to worship. And so here's what we read, Psalm 126, a song of degrees. When the Lord turned again the captivity of Zion, we were like them that dream. Then was our mouth filled with laughter and our tongue with singing. Then said they among the heathen, the Lord hath done great things for them. The Lord hath done great things for us, whereof we are glad. Turn again our captivity, O Lord, as the streams in the south. They that sow in tears shall reap in joy. He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. And that's why we've come together this morning. We've come together to proclaim the great things that the Lord has done and has made us glad because of his work. We want to take this good news to others. And we want to be faithful about that, passionate about that, and we know that God will give us the increase for that labor. So let's go ahead and have a word of prayer together, and then we'll be seated. I'm going to share some prayer requests after that, and we'll have a word of prayer again before our choir sings. But Father in heaven, I thank you for your goodness. I thank you for the fact that the only way to come to the Father is through Jesus the Son. And we have that access because Christ has died in our place. And he didn't just die for our sins, but he was resurrected from the grave. And Father, if we put our faith and trust in Christ, turning from our sins in repentance and turning to him in faith, we have salvation, rescue from the penalty of our sins, and access to you. As we just sung and as we just read, there is much about which to rejoice because of your grace in Christ's sacrifice and resurrection. I thank you for each soul who is here this morning. What a blessing it is to be able to worship together. I thank you for the guests that we have today, those who are returning guests and those who are here with us for the first time. And what a blessing that is for them to be with us as we worship. Thank you for our faithful membership. We pray for those who are unable to be with us. And Lord, we lift them up to you. And it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Before we sing, I want to share a couple prayer requests with you that are really pressing. We're praying for Linda Proctor. We've been holding her up before the Lord. Her brother Jim told me this morning that tomorrow morning they're going to be meeting with hospice, the family is. So we understand what that means when that starts to enter into the discussion. So keep Linda Proctor in your prayers. Brother Sam Ford came home on Thursday. He's recovering from his leg break and his hip replacement. And then James Cox is not with us today because his dad has really taken a turn for the worse in Florida, and he left for Florida. Yesterday morning is when he left out for Florida. So keep Howard Cox and that family, if you would, in your prayers. We got quite a few number who are sick and shut-ins. We want to hold them up in our prayers, and we want to do that right now. Let's pray to the Lord, thanking him for his goodness and asking his blessing on these requests and the rest of our worship this morning. But let's have a word of prayer together right now. Brother Gary Meek, would you lead us in prayer, brother?
Thank you.
Let's all stand together and we're going to sing number 705, It Is Well With My Soul. You may be seated. Brother Charles Crabtree, will you lead us in a word of prayer?
For this awesome opportunity and privilege to come together as brothers and sisters in Christ, yes, and hear your word preached. We pray that you'll open our hearts to your Holy Spirit, that you'll give us the grace to be obedient to your word. Yes. We'll give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Be thou my
That's one of my all-time favorite hymns. I was telling Ethan, and I asked him to sing a special. I asked him, I don't know how many weeks ago it was, if he would sing a special today, and he didn't know exactly where I would be in our study of 1 Peter. I hope you'll recognize as we work our way through the study this morning, 1 Peter chapter 5, if you want to open your Bibles up there, that is good, what he just sang. And Carrie and Alex accompanied him on, is going to fit perfectly with what we're talking about from Scriptures this morning. And I love how the Lord orchestrates those things and works them out. It's one of my favorite hymns, though. Actually, it was translated from Irish Gaelic into English a few decades before even the King James translated was translated into English. It's a very old hymn, but like anything that's true, it doesn't matter how ancient or how contemporary it is. If it's true, it rings solid, amen, and resonates. And when I was ordained in 2003, I got to pick out all the music for that ordination service, and that was one of the hymns that I had chosen, "Be Thou My Vision." Because that was my desire then, and it is still my desire for the high king of heaven to be my vision. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou my vision now and always. That's my desire, and I hope that will be yours as well, if it isn't. But we're gonna read from 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 8 and 9. Here in just a minute. We're going to talk about the adversary, and we have one. Over 300 years ago, speaking about things that are old, over 300 years ago, the Puritan pastor Thomas Brooks wrote to his congregation about the adversary, the very topic that we're going to discuss this morning. And here's what he wrote, and he said this in part: Christ, the scripture, your own hearts, and Satan's devices are four prime things that should be first and most studied and searched. If any cast off the study of these, they cannot be safe here nor happy hereafter. And it is my work as a Christian, but much more as I am a watchman, to do my best to discover the fullness of Christ, the emptiness of the creature, and the snares of the great deceiver. And like Thomas Brooks, I am also, as your pastor, a watchman. And my prayer is that this morning, as we look into sacred scripture, we will see the fullness of Christ, the emptiness of the creature, and the snares of the deceiver. And with that in mind, let's read 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 8 and 9. Here's what scripture says to us: Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about, seeking whom he may devour. Whom? Resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions that are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. And so, Father in heaven, we ask you to bless the reading, the proclamation, the understanding, and the application of your word. And Father, may our minds not wander, may our hearts not become distracted. May we, for the next 30 to 40 minutes, be focused not so much on the words of a man, but on the promptings of the Holy Spirit as he takes his word and chisels it into our heart, mind, and soul. And it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. I have found over the course of my life that not only is this true of me at times, but it's especially true of most people. And most people, even more than I find myself, are drawn to the strange and are drawn to the supernatural. That's why if you to announce you're going to do a series on Revelation, you'll get people out of the woodwork, even people who don't belong to your church, because they are drawn, many people are, to the strange and to the supernatural, that which doesn't sound typical. And so the power and the mystery that lies beyond our own comprehension enthralls us. And knowing that, we must be careful not to seek answers, not to seek clues, not to seek information about the supernatural apart from God's word. Amen? When it comes to these strange, supernatural things that we cannot explain, this is where we must look for answers, not to other places. We must be sure to not mix biblical truth with legends and superstitions and current popular themes. Scripture alone must inform our minds about that which is spiritual, because it is the only true, trustworthy source. All that the Lord desires for us to understand, no matter what the topic is, all that the Lord desires for us to understand, especially about the supernatural and the strange, is revealed in Scripture. Any other source of information should be, if not avoided, should be treated with severe skepticism. So therefore, when it comes to the adversary, we don't learn about our adversary from popular culture. We don't learn about our adversary from high culture, like Dante's Inferno or Milton's Paradise Lost. The arts, the occult, popular culture, Ouija boards, no matter where you are on the spectrum of those things, they are inadequate to inform you about the origins, the designs, and the ultimate, praise God, destruction of our enemy. The Bible is the only pure, accurate guide of all these things, including truth in regard to our adversary. And so if the Bible is going to be taken seriously, and I hope you do take the Bible seriously, but if the Bible is to be taken seriously, then we must recognize what it teaches about the satanic realm, because it does. It does teach about that. Scripture clearly demonstrates that God's people have actual adversaries, and those actual adversaries are not flesh and blood opponents who are different from you politically or different from you morally or different from you on any other kind of range of topics. Those are not your adversaries, Scripture teaches us. Scripture demonstrates that God's people have adversaries, and those adversaries are Satan and his demonic host, and they are powerful, and they are bent on the destruction and the perversion of God's people and God's glory. But praise God, that's not the whole story. Because while Satan and his host are real, and while they are real powerful, they are defeated. Do you believe that? I hope you do, and I hope you'll recognize that as we move along. We need to recognize that this real adversary that we have, who is mentioned, the only reason I'm talking about him right now, I'm not giving place to the devil, as Paul says in Ephesians 4, but I'm talking about him and his host right now because that's what our text mentions in 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 8 and 9. We are instructed about how to resist him, and so that's what we're going to talk about this morning. But we need to recognize that our adversary, while he is real, he is not God, he is not like God. He is a created being, not created to be evil, but fell from his original position as an angelic being that glorified and brought glory and honor to God. You can read about this in the prophecy of Isaiah and in the prophecy of Ezekiel. Both of them deal with this and the fall of Lucifer. That's not going to be our focus this morning, but you can look up those places. But this created being who fell from his glorified estate does not have the power. He is not equal with God. Satan is not somehow some spiritual brother equal with Jesus Christ. Those are things that you will hear other faith traditions teach, and nothing could be further from the truth. It is heretical, in fact. There is nothing accurate about that. Remember, Scripture alone must inform us about these things, not pop culture, not other religious texts, but Scripture alone. And we understand from Scripture that these enemies contend with the Lord of glory, but they are fighting the long defeat. Now, all of you are probably familiar with the caricature of Satan. I know when I was in middle school, it used to be before my little town where I grew up, before it consolidated and became South Dearborn High School, there were three high schools that were individual. And so those individual high schools kept their, for the middle school teams, kept their old logo and team names. So I went through sixth, seventh, and eighth grade and played basketball for the Aurora Red Devils. And I've learned that some of you used to be a Red Devil and some of you used to be a Blue Devil around here, right? That's some of the things that I've learned. You're not devils now, right, but we understand that. But here's the thing. Right along the scorer's bench of our gym, which was an old-time gym there in southeastern Indiana, and there was, you know, propped up on his elbow, this typical caricature. Red suit, horns, long, pointy tail, bad goatee, a sinister grin, and a trident in one hand. Y'all have seen stuff like that. You've seen that either for the logos of high schools or in other types of environments. That cartoonish image of the enemy, the adversary, originated in the Middle Ages. And you shouldn't think that Christians from centuries ago honestly believed that Satan looked that idiotic. They didn't think that. They portrayed him as a clown on purpose. The medievals wanted to depict him as the buffoon of all time, as the ultimate loser of the ages for his rebellion against the King of Glory. And the purpose of the caricature was to strike at Satan's pride. In fact, it was the reformer Martin Luther who suggested that when the devil persists in tempting you, this is a quote from Luther, you should jeer and flout him, for he cannot bear scorn. I think that's bad advice. That's bad advice. The medievals, in fact, in my opinion, paid too much attention to the adversary. But if they were guilty of paying too much attention to the adversary, our culture is guilty of the opposite extreme and not paying any attention to the enemy of God's people today. The devil is real. Satan is not a boogeyman. He's not an old wives' tale. He is not the product of Hollywood horror films. He is more than just a Halloween costume. He is not a relic from an ancient and superstitious era of human history meant to scare kids into behaving well. And even so, even the fact that he is real and we have a real adversary, it is not uncommon for people today, including professing Christians, to scoff at the idea of the reality of our adversary. In fact, theologians such as one named Rudolf Bultmann emphatically denies the existence of the supernatural on any level, angels or demons. And he argued that these kind of quote-unquote myths should be demythologized and removed so that contemporary modern scientific people could receive the gospel. Well, look, if we believe that there is a God who created us and who put on flesh and who died for our sins and was resurrected from the grave and is going to resurrect us someday, why wouldn't we believe that there is likewise this demonic host that is against us and opposed to God's agenda and seeking to thwart it, if that were even possible? That's what we need to understand, not because I think so, not because tradition says so, but because Scripture says so. Scripture says that our adversary is real, and he is no one's friend. He is not in hell now. Don't believe that. Satan's headquarters is not in hell. He doesn't have an office in the corner of the fiery pit. In fact, he's never been there. He's going to be there. There is going to come a time when Jesus Christ will chain and ensnare and imprison that old serpent into the hell that was created for him. Amen. That day is coming. But it is not yet. So when people sing along that hell is going to be a party time and all my friends are going to be there too, and they're on the highway to that place, because how could it not be a fun place to be? That's where all the cool people, that's where all the loose people, all the stiffs are going to be somewhere else. But the people who like to cut loose a little bit, they're going to be in hell, and there's a highway to it, and it's going to be a party time. Nothing could be further from the truth. It's not a party time now. It won't be a party time then. And it is the final place for not just Satan, but all those who reject Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And so this adversary is no one's friend. Jesus said, speaking to a religious group who were opposed to Christ and what he was teaching, he said that you're a father of the devil. And here's why, because you are a liar and you're liars and murderers. And that's what he was from the beginning, not from his creation, but from the time that he fell. And that's exactly what they were. That's exactly what the Pharisees and the religious establishment of Jesus' day did. They lied about Jesus. They lied about themselves, and they eventually murdered Jesus. Paul said that it's no surprise when people masquerade as believers and lead believers away. It's no surprise because Satan himself masquerades, transformed into an angel of light. This idea that that Satan would be recognizable because he would look so evil. He comes at people not as an ogre, but as an angel of light who needs to be listened to, who needs to be heard and hear out this argument and consider these things. That's exactly how he came to Eve in the garden. And somebody says, well, man, he came to Eve. And here's things that are strange and supernatural, and we have to understand them from a biblical level. So, man, he came to her as a serpent. That's what Genesis 3 says. And all I can tell you is evidently, from the beginning, that animal didn't have the kind of fear and dread connected to it that we have connected to it today. And he came to her in that guise, and he spoke to Eve in the garden, and he caused her to doubt if God had even spoken. Hath God said? And then he caused her to doubt that what God had spoken was for her good. You shall not surely die. God's just holding out on you. He doesn't want you to become like he is. And beloved, I'm kind of getting ahead of myself a little bit today. But the strategy, the operation of the adversary is exactly the same. He wants to get you to doubt that God has even spoken. Is this really God's word? That guy keeps talking about that. He keeps saying that. But isn't that just a book? Isn't that just another book, an ancient book? Yeah, and it's got some good stuff in it. You ought to pay attention to some of the moral teachings. It makes sense. But can that really be God's divine word? It's just another book. And then get you to doubt. Well, yeah, but is that really how you should understand that? Is that really how you should order your life? I don't think that sounds that good. That's exactly what Satan does today. And the exact opposite of that is Jesus Christ, who is not the enemy, but the friend of sinners, who is the way, the truth, and the life. And those who come to him by faith are opposed by a real adversary. C.S. Lewis, in his book, The Screwtape Letters, which is a creative look at conversations between a demon named Screwtape, who is trying, and his minions, as well as the adversary, and trying to tempt men and lead them away and blind their eyes to from the gospel truth. And in the preface to that book, The Screwtape Letters, C.S. Lewis wrote this: there are two equal and opposite errors into which our race can fall about the devils. One is to disbelieve in their existence, and the other is to believe and to feel an excessive, unhealthy interest in them. They themselves are equally pleased by both errors and hail a materialist or a magician with the same delight. And I agree. I agree with C.S. Lewis, and I believe that Satan is effective at tricking us into following one of these two patterns. The first is to underestimate him so that he can lure us into some type of hidden snare. And the second is to overestimate him so that we're constantly scared, where we're praying the devil out from underneath every rock. And every time something bad happens, you watch the news and you see what's going on, or you hear about something in your family, and you start to think, oh, what's the devil up to now? And we give him a lot more credit than he deserves. And if we don't do that, then we totally ignore him and his temptations in our life. And we have to be wary of both false narratives, not to underestimate him or to overestimate him. And we need to recognize that Satan himself desires to be like God. Satan himself desires to sit on God's throne. Satan himself desires to be worshiped as God. And those are all personal goals that he knows he will never attain. But what he desires is for mankind to reject God's authority just as he did, so that mankind will share his fate. He wants to keep your soul, if you're lost, if you haven't believed the gospel. I didn't say if you were conservative. He doesn't care about that. He doesn't care if you're conservative or liberal. He doesn't care if you're moral or immoral or amoral. And I'm not saying all those things are equal, but the adversary doesn't care where you fall politically, where you fall morally. He doesn't care what your view on the war in Eastern Europe is. He doesn't care what your view on Black Lives Matter is. He doesn't care if you back the blue or protest the blue. He wants to keep your soul separated from God. And you could be all of those things, any of those things, both of those things, all of them, and not trust in the Savior, right? And he has accomplished his goal. He wants to keep your soul separated from God. He wants to prevent, if you're saved, he wants to prevent your practice from matching your possession. Scripture teaches us that if you're a believer, you are, Ephesians says, seated with God, seated with Christ in the heavenly places. God's word says that if you're a believer, you are clothed in the righteousness of Christ. You carry his righteousness. It doesn't mean that you've been made righteous on your own and have no need of Christ. It means that you've been covered and are clothed in the righteousness of Christ. He has, to use a technical term, he has imputed his righteousness. You are counted righteous in Jesus Christ. And there's a difference between the imputation of Christ's righteousness and the impartation. I don't believe the Bible teaches the impartation of righteousness as if we become righteous on our own because of anything. But we have Christ's righteousness imputed to us, counted to us. The distinction is important because without Christ, we have no hope. Amen. That's all of us. That's all of us. And he wants, if you're a believer, he wants your practice to not match your profession. And again, he doesn't care what agenda may take your mind off of following Christ, as long as you're not pursuing Christ, it's right down his alley. And the adversary wants to divide the family and corrupt the society. And I'm using those terms institutionally. You know, every families, all societies. And just as the adversary tempted Eve in the garden, hath God said, and is what God said really good, and he fanned the flames of jealousy in Cain's heart, in Genesis 4, 6 and 7, Cain was to offer up a blood sacrifice, just as Abel did. It was picturing the coming sacrifice of Christ, and that's not what Cain offered, and his offering, therefore, wasn't acceptable, and the flames of jealousy were fanned, and Cain murdered his brother Abel, a jealousy which culminated in that human blood, the first human blood being spilled on the earth. The family is God's design. And I want you to understand that our adversary seeks to destroy and degrade everything that is God's design. And so the family is God's design. The family is not just the invention of human societies that we've decided over the course of our evolution. This is the best way for our species. This is the best way for our culture to advance, is if we focus it around these family units. And then over time, in different places, in different eras, the idea of family slowly evolved. That's a bunch of hogwash. The family is God's design. God created Adam. God created Eve. He performed the first wedding ceremony in the garden, and they were to procreate and not just procreate, but to propagate the goodness of God's grace and to have dominion over the creation that he made and in which he set them down. So the family and marriage is God's design, not man's, not the government's. And it doesn't matter if a constitutional republic passes constitutional amendments that say what marriage is or what marriage isn't, they don't have that authority. Now, they can pass the laws, they can rule on these issues, and they can say this and they can say that, and if you disagree or if I disagree, they can haul you before the magistrates and judge you according to those laws. That's perfectly legitimate. But when it's perfectly legitimate as far as their civil government is concerned, but it's not right, it's not correct, and it's not right and it's not correct because the Constitution says so or not, but what does God's Word have to say about it? And that's what's been so fantastic about our nation down through history, is that quite often, not always, but quite often, what has been the official law of the land has also matched God's Word. But it doesn't matter if it does or doesn't. What matters is, will we obey God's Word or will we obey the culture? If we obey God's Word, we're fighting the adversary. If we go along to get along with the culture and the civil authorities and whoever else, we are giving in to the strategy of the adversary. Does that make sense? The family is not just for procreation, but for propagation of the faith from one generation to the next. And the family, more so even than the local church, is beleaguered by dysfunction, disobedience, abuse, and immorality, and materialism, and addictions. And especially in our culture, you don't just have abuse going on, but you have so often kids who lead their families. The families are organized around what the kids want to do or what the parents want the kids to pursue or whatever else. And there is no kind of God-honoring, God-focused, biblically-informed understanding of the family. It has all gone crazy in so many ways. And that's not by default. That's by design. Not by God's design, but by the adversary's design. Because no church and no culture will be any stronger or any healthier than the families in that culture and in that church. And whether they kill them or corrupt them, Satan's design is to wreak havoc on God's creation. Now, our adversary is real, and he has a strategy. And we've been warned by Peter that we are to be sober and be vigilant because our adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about seeking whom he may devour. And that guy, we need to resist steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same afflictions are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. You're not the only one, by the way, to feel the sting of his darts, to feel his breath on your neck. So, we've talked about his reality. We've talked about his strategy. Now, let's land the plane by talking about three keys to victory. And they're not just keys, they're commands. I hope you saw it. If you like to mark up your Bible, mark up these phrases. Verse 8. The first two are back-to-back in verse 8. These are commands. These are not suggestions. Be sober. Be vigilant. And then the third command is verse 9, resist steadfast, and you resist steadfast in the faith. These three commands expressed in these two verses give us the three keys to victory over our real and our really strategic adversary. I call the first one be self-controlled, because that in the King James English, be sober is talking about being self-controlled. And you know, we often use the word sober in relation to alcohol or drugs, and that makes sense, right? Because if you're sober, you are not under the control of anything intoxicating, whether it's alcohol or some other type of controlled substance. We are to be in control. And this is a call not just for us to bite our lip and suck it up and wipe off the blood and the dirt and to get it done ourselves. It's not just calling for that. This is calling for us to be self-controlled under the Spirit's control. This is the call to be sober and to lead a life that's Holy Spirit-led. How do we know if a life is Holy Spirit-led? Well, is it Holy Scripture-directed? That's the only way to know. The only way to know if you're led by the Spirit is if you're obeying the book that the Spirit inspired, which is the Bible. And this is to have a disciplined heart and mind. I beat that drum on a regular basis, unapologetically, because I believe that that too often we are undisciplined in heart and mind, and we pay the price. And I think too often that kind of agenda gets taught, even if by accident. We need to be self-controlled, and that means to have a control of our own mind. Listen, a control of our own mind, and therefore control of our own mouth. If your mouth isn't under control, it's because your mind isn't under control, right? Because as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he, and so does he speak. Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So if you have your mind under control, you have your mouth under control. If you have your heart under control, you have your habits under control. And by the way, Scripture doesn't make a distinction between heart and mind. We do. Well, that guy played with a lot of heart. That guy's an intelligent player, but he doesn't play with a lot of passion or whatever else. And we use all kind of terms like that, and it's fantastic if you're talking about your ball team, but it's foolish when you're talking about yourself in relation to living for Christ. In Scripture, heart and mind are not distinct. They're just different terms to describe the same thing, the way we think, the way we emote, and who we are. If you want, at least in the King James, if you want a term that talks about feeling, then you need to use bowels, because that is what the King James uses to talk about how you feel. And that makes sense, right? Have you ever had butterflies in your stomach? Has your stomach ever churned because you become nervous with something? Absolutely. We all understand what that means. And Scripture uses that term to talk about how we feel about something. And look, if you look back with me, Peter is just repeating something that he has said before. Look at chapter 1, verse 13. Peter's repeating, right? Repeat and repeat. That's he does it all through this letter. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 13. I love it. I love how it reads in the King James. It's so graphic. Wherefore, gird up the loins of your mind and be sober. Because these people, even the men, they didn't wear breeches like we did. We get into these silly arguments about, I'm not going to go down that road, we get in these silly arguments about women not wearing men's trousers and all kind of nonsense like that. Thankfully, that's not something we have to deal with a bunch right here. But these guys didn't wear breeches like I've got on. They wore robes. The men. Long, flowing robes. And what 1 Peter 1:13 is saying is to gird up the loins of your mind. It's an image that they would have understood. Gird up your robe and have it tucked in. Ephesians chapter 6, the belt of truth. It's not talking about a WWE Worldwide Wrestling Championship belt. It's a belt that you would wear and you gird your robe in so that you wouldn't trip over your own 2 feet when you have to be active. And that's what this is saying. Gird up the loins of your mind for action and be sober. And then if you look in chapter 4 of 1 Peter, in verse 7, what do you do when the world's coming to an end? Here's what you do. But the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. The point is to be clear-minded and self-controlled. Clear-minded and self-controlled. The two things go together. Somebody who's not under self-control is not somebody who's thinking clearly. And if you're thinking clearly, you're going to have to control yourself. Within some sectors of Christianity, there is actually, listen to me, listen to this, pastor. Within some sectors of Christianity, there is actually a de-emphasis on self-controlled rationality and an emphasis on feelings, emotions, and experiences. And those within that camp suggest that spirituality, if you really want it to be spiritual, if we're really getting spiritual here, if we're really being spiritual about this, if a fella or a gal is really spiritual, then that's not something so much understood as it's felt. How'd that make you feel? What do you feel about that? Well, here's what I feel about that. Well, I feel, and worship isn't about learning, but worshiping is about experiencing. And can I say to you, that isn't true. At least it's not completely true. We know Jesus. We worship Jesus, and we get connected to him through our minds first. And it doesn't matter what kind of feeling you have. It doesn't matter how amped up you are. It doesn't matter how many times your feet leave the floor or your hands stay up or whatever else. And I don't think there's anything wrong with any of that. But you can't gin that up on your own and say, I'm worshiping. You have to know and worship Jesus according as he is revealed in his word. Anything else is just painted fire. And painted fire can look hot. But I don't recommend you stand next to it on a cold morning and try to get warm, because it might look good, but it's not the real thing. Listen to what God's word has to say. Psalm 32:8-9, I will instruct thee and teach thee in the way that you shall go. I will guide you with mine eye. Be ye not as the horse or as the mule, which has no understanding, whose mouth must be held in with bit and bridle, lest they come near unto thee. And then Philippians 4:8, I absolutely love this. And this is why I love Be Thou My Vision, and why I'm so happy that Ethan sung that this morning. And he talks about the second half of the first verse. I brought it up here with me because I couldn't remember it off the top of my head. Thou my best thought. Not my best feeling. I mean, everything affects my feelings. Everything affects my feelings. From what I eat to what I don't eat. To how often I eat and how late I eat. Right? To how much I drink and how much I don't drink. And I'm not talking about alcohol. I'm talking about coffee or Dr. Pepper or water or whatever else. Or sweet tea. Everything. What this person says, what that person doesn't say, if that person's here, if that person's not here. Everything affects my feelings, and it can affect them all kinds of ways. I'm not saying there's something wrong with that. I'm saying that can't be the basis of what we know and do and how we act and think. Thou my best thought by day or by night, waking or sleeping. Your presence, my light. I mean, it's Philippians 4:8. Whatever is true, whatever is honest, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is good, if there's any virtue, if there's any praise, help me out. Think on these things. And look at those words. It's not just truth and honesty and justice, but it's purity and loveliness and good report and virtuous and praise. These emotive words, but the emotions come from what we know to be true, not what we're trying to get worked up to. And in order to overcome our adversary, we must constantly fill ourselves with divine truth, allowing it to saturate our minds and change our hearts. And we will know that our minds are saturated and our hearts changed by the truth, by what we say and what we do. That's how you know if your mind's saturated by the truth. How do you speak? What do you say? How do you act? Where do you go? How do you spend your time and your money and yourself? Well, let's go to number two. Be self-controlled and be single-minded. Be single-minded in your pursuit of Christ. I love Philippians chapter 3. When I was at that revival this last week, I preached from it. I've preached from it here a bunch of times. It was our first focus under my pastorate. Philippians 3:13, brethren, I count not myself, this is Paul talking, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth to those things which are before, I press on for the mark of the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Have that be your single-minded focus. Keep your eyes open. Don't put your head in the sand. Don't close your eyes. You know, don't become Sergeant Schultz and you see nothing, you hear nothing, you speak nothing. That's not how you get through in this world. You don't act like everything's roses all the time. You have a single-minded biblical focus on these things. You keep your eyes fixed on Christ, not fixed on the news, not fixed on current events, not fixed. It doesn't mean that you're hiding from the news. It doesn't mean you're hiding from current events. But that's not what's guiding you. If you are in Him, then you fight from victory, not for victory. So be strong in the grace and the strength that's in Christ Jesus. And be alert. Watch your surroundings. Watch your relationships. Take stock of the potential temptations that the adversary will bring into your life. And be single-minded. Be single-minded in what you refuse. And be single-minded in what you choose. And then finally, and here we come to a close. Be steadfast. So be self-control, that's be sober. Be single-minded, that's be vigilant. Or be alert, you might be reading. Watchful. And then be steadfast. We resist the adversary by being, and this is important, I probably should have put this on the screen, by being steadfast in the faith. James said, resist the devil and he'll flee from you. And he's not going to flee from you because of you. Do you know, hell doesn't shake because Travis Gilbert has preached a sermon. Do you understand that? It doesn't matter to them. But let me tell you what causes our adversary to get weak in the knees, and that is the name of Jesus Christ the Lord. And not by this, not I bind you in the name. Hey, look, and if I'm offending somebody right now, it is not my intent, but I want you to understand on the basis of Scripture, this business of I bind you in the name of, that's a bunch of hooey. That's not at all what God's Word teaches us to do. Jesus Christ is the strong man, and here's how you resist the devil. You flee from him, and you are strong in Christ. I don't go chest to chest with Satan. I don't go up and trade punches with the enemy. I just clothe myself in my Christ. That's it. I'm not arm wrestling the adversary. I'm pleading Jesus. He is on my side, and He makes all the difference. We don't fight for victory. We fight from it. We stand firm in the faith by His grace and power, not our own, but by Christ and in Christ and for Christ. Steadfast in the faith, and that's how we resist the adversary. So Paul says, and this sounds funny in the King James, wherefore, watch ye, stand fast in the faith, quit you like men. It doesn't mean quit and walk out. It means acquit yourself. It means act like a man. Be courageous and be strong. And then Ephesians 6:10, finally, my brethren, be strong where? And in the power of what? And repeatedly in that section of Ephesians chapter 6, when it comes to, which is the armor of God section, it starts there in verse 10 and runs through verse 20. Repeatedly, we are told to stand firm. Four times, as a matter of fact, we're told to stand. Victory is assured, not by your personal tenacity, but by the finished work of Christ on the cross and in His resurrection. That is why without Christ, we are without hope. And that's why the adversary is fully defeated because of Jesus Christ. In other words, it is our theology which is to control our practice. And I'm not going to take you there because my time is done, but Matthew chapter 4, when Jesus was tempted, hey, look, Satan is not, here's attributes that God has that we don't have. Omniscience, that means all-knowing. Omnipotent, that means all-powerful, and omnipresent, that means everywhere at once. It doesn't mean that God's in the wood or God's in the sheetrock or God's in the trees. It doesn't mean that kind of nonsense. It means that God is, nothing happens apart from His knowledge and understanding and His presence, okay? You and I are not omniscient, omnipresent, or omnipotent, and either is Satan. He is not that. But our adversary has been around since before humans. The angelic beings were created first. You can look that up in Scripture. And so from the first, when Adam was created, there was the adversary, and he is a student of humanity, and he knows how to push your buttons. And by the way, That's why you don't need to say everything. Not to me, not to your spouse, not even to yourself. Because the enemy, the adversary, can't read your mind, but he knows how to speak English. Are y'all following me? So you can pray to God, and there are things that we need to pray out loud, obviously, but don't give the adversary ammunition that he can use to shoot you. Does that make sense? Don't do that. Instead, resist him steadfast in the faith. In Matthew chapter 4, verses 3 through 11, when Jesus was tempted, if Satan will tempt Jesus, he doesn't fear taking a shot at you. And over again, Jesus resisted that temptation by saying, it is written, it is written, it is written. And by the way, look at verse 9 again one more time before we taxi up to the gate. It says, knowing the same afflictions that are accomplished in your brethren that are in the world. Beloved, you are not alone. First and foremost, there is the example in the presence of Jesus, but there are others, those who have gone before us, who have fought and who are fighting the same spiritual battle as we are. Beloved, we have an adversary, and he is a good strategist for blinding the eyes of those who need the gospel and of tempting those who have believed the gospel. And like the Apostle John said, ye are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is what? In you than he that is in the world. And as we wrap this up, that's my question, that's my first question to you. Is he in you, Jesus? Do you know him, and does he know you as his own? Again, I'm not asking you if you like gospel music. It's good if you do. I'm not asking you if you're a conservative, down-home Kentuckian. That's fantastic if you are. I'm not asking you if your habit is to go to church on a regular basis. I think that's a good habit, and you need to have that. What I'm asking you is, do you know Christ? Is he your Lord and Savior? And then second, if he is in you, are you resisting the adversary steadfast in the faith, or try to do it on your own? Are you, with a single-minded focus, being under the control of God's holy word, led by the Spirit, so that you can resist the devil and he'll flee far from you? So would you stand with me, and once you get to your feet, bow your head and close your eyes, and our musicians are going to come, and we're going to sing a different kind of invitation song. We're going to sing Onward Christian Soldiers. I thought it would be a fitting for this based on what we've discussed this morning from God's Word. And we're going to sing it, and if you need to come, then this is an opportunity for you to come. Maybe you want to pray and pray at this altar and commit yourself to this kind of fight and fighting this kind of way. Or maybe you need and want some counsel from me or want to pray with me. I don't know how the Spirit may be leading in your heart and mind, but I do know this, we're all in a fight. It's spiritual warfare, not spiritual shadow boxing. And we can't fight this fight on our own, but we have a resource, we have a power, and it's Christ and his word. And so, Father in heaven, I pray that we will fight with all of our might, recognizing that we fight from victory, not for it, and recognizing that there's one way to fight, and that's according to what your word teaches us, to be, Father, sober, vigilant, and steadfast, self-controlled, Father, to be single-minded, and to be standing firm in the faith. And I pray that we will. I'm thankful that we have. Forgive us and forgive me when I haven't. And Father, may we glorify your name by how we conduct ourselves in every aspect of our lives. And it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. As we sing, if you need to come.
marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. Christ the royal master leads against the foe. Forward into battle, see his banners go. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war. With the cross of Jesus going on before.
I'm going to share some announcements and then we'll dismiss. Instead of dismissing with a prayer, we'll sing the next verse of, we'll sing the last verse of Onward, Christian Soldiers as we're dismissed. And once that verse is finished, you'll be dismissed. And if I haven't had a chance to meet you yet, or if I've only met you, or if I've known you forever, or if I've only got a chance to meet you once or twice, I'd love my wife and I to press the flesh a little bit as you make your exit this morning or this afternoon by now out our back doors. There is a family that's here for the first time, Dusty and his family. I'm not trying to embarrass them at all, but I'm bringing him up because I first met Dusty at Bibles and Biscuits, right? That's what you're reminding me of. He knows Charles Crabtree, and he came to church anyway. I think that's pretty awesome. I think Charles has invited him to Bibles and Biscuits, and he knows some people here. He figured that out right away when he got here. But Bibles and Biscuits, guys, is coming up this Tuesday morning at 7 a.m. at Marcellus. You bring your Bibles and order some biscuits and bacon and whatever else, and we'll have a good time together. Brother Charles, even though I picked on him, leads that Bible study and does a fantastic job with that. We're also going to have a diner on Wednesday night for Operation Christmas Child. We've been doing that all year long. Information about that is in your bulletin. And next Sunday night, you've seen these flyers posted up, and I put them in the bulletin. Diana did, actually. Greater Vision will be with us next Sunday night. So next Sunday night, which is Mother's Day, it's a great treat for you and Mom. You come on here, and we'll have a great time together. Praising God with being led by these great gospel musicians tonight, or next Sunday night at 6 p.m. Tonight at 6, we're going to meet together, but we're going to meet up in the Family Life Center. And our teens are going to take leadership in the service. They're going to lead the singing. We'll have a couple songs. They'll start us off with a couple songs and then lead us in prayer. Everything, they're going to lead in all that. And then Brother Jamie is going to get up and he's going to preach. And after he preaches, he'll close us out with a word of blessing on the worship, but also a blessing on a meal, because after the worship time, we're going to have a meal. And whatever you contribute for that meal. So instead of going to Limestone or Wendy's or Arby's or someplace like that tonight or going out of town, come up here and enjoy worship and fellowship and get your meal here tonight. And what's on the menu? Barbecue. It's going to be fantastic, and all the proceeds from that meal are going to go towards helping our teens with offset the cost of teen camp. Teen camp's $315 a person. It's not cheap, and so and that doesn't count travel costs. So we want as many teens to be able to go to teen camp as possible, and this is going to help offset that cost. Whatever you give for the food will go towards that 100%. If you have a church shirt, and the church shirts that we've been waiting on have arrived, they should be out there on the table. If you haven't paid for your church shirt yet, you can see Diana, because it might be here. We haven't put the shirts that haven't been paid for out there yet, but if you've paid for your shirt, it's out there, except for maybe just a couple cases, but they're there. You can see Diana about that if you have any kind of questions. Wear that tonight. If you don't have a new church shirt, wear an old church shirt. If you don't have an old church shirt, just wear something, and that'd be better than nothing. And we'll see you tonight at 6, and that will be a great blessing. But let's go ahead and be dismissed in a word of prayer. Alex, why don't you dismiss us in prayer, brother?
Now go ahead and say.
Onward then, ye people, join our happy throng. Lend with us your voices in the triumph song. Glory, laud, and honor unto Christ the King. This through countless ages men and angels sing. Onward, Christian soul.